Hey there. Thanks so much for joining us today. As Garrett said, I'm Katie McAuliffe with Americans for Tax Reform and Digital Liberty, and I am happy to be talking with Michael Kratsios, Assistant to the President for Technology Policy, and serves as President Donald Trump's top technology advisor. So we're going to jump right into the questions so that you guys can hear as much from him as possible. And why don't you start out by talking a bit about your role in the office and kind of how it fits into the tech policy process?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's kind of very important to kind of put in context the way that the federal government thinks about, the regulatory approaches to technology. And I think something that I've realized kind of over my time is probably obvious to a lot of you here, that the process is very complex and time-consuming. And we have a very large federal apparatus, and each of the agencies that, you know, Adam was talking about, they have their own systems and processes of creating rules and moving through that. But the way that generally tech policy is thought of, at least from our perspective, is from the White House, is beginning with the first principles of what the president's agenda is. In our case, it's very clear that the president is driving a pro-economic growth agenda that supports economic growth and jobs, and is one that looks carefully at the importance of national security. So as we sort of start building a tech agenda, those are kind of our guiding, our sort of North Stars in a sense. And from a White House standpoint, you know, we spend a lot of time thinking about what the very sort of higher level, broad technology policy themes are that then should permeate down to the agencies that are actually making the regulations. So through these interagency processes where the White House is a convener of sorts, where we bring the relevant stakeholders from all the agencies to the White House and amongst ourselves kind of come to the consensus on whatever the issue of the day may be, whether it's drones or autonomous vehicles or AI or whatever it may be.
And so your perspective on this is, you know, different, and certainly your path in getting to the White House is a little bit different than the typical, you know, Washington bureaucrat. So why don't you tell us a little bit about how you ended up in the White House?
Yeah, so prior to Washington, I spent almost 7 years here in San Francisco, and I worked for venture capitalist Peter Thiel for my time out here. And you know, I think what, you know, I've always been excited or was fascinated about politics, but I think what we tended to see kind of in the last few years before I moved to D.C. was, as we were looking at technology investments, the emphasis and the time that we were spending at sort of analyzing the regulatory risk associated with these particular investments continued to increase over the years. And there were some very prominent investments that sort of we had been looking at prior to, you know, my move, places like SpaceX, worrying about how you can get the right rules around launches and expedite sort of launch approvals at Commerce and DOT and the other agencies. We saw on the local level with investments like Lyft, we're sort of dealing with some of the issues Adam was talking about as well, and even places, companies like Stripe that are dealing with sort of financial services regulations. And for me, I think this, you know, having the ability or the opportunity to be in a place in Washington where you can actually effectuate change in these areas that can actually help the innovators and the entrepreneurs around the country develop their technologies without kind of the regulatory burdens that often hamstring them was something that was very exciting to me and I spent the last year and a half tackling.
And so this experience has, you know, helped you form these policy priorities and whatnot that you all are working on. So what are you most focused on right now in terms of priorities for the White House?
Yeah, absolutely. So back to kind of what I mentioned a little bit earlier, the North Star really is economic growth and jobs and national security. And as we were developing our agenda early last year, we wanted to figure out how can we map to that agenda our tech priorities. And our first one that we've been charging at pretty hard for the last 18 months is a focus on promoting emerging technologies in the U.S. This realization that, you know, in order to ensure continued American prosperity and economic growth, we need to maintain our leadership in emerging technologies, whether it's the obvious ones like drones or autonomous vehicles, or even next generation technologies like artificial intelligence and quantum information sciences. We need to ensure that America is the home for the next great technological developments. And we think about all the different levers that the federal government can pull to ensure that, whether it's a sort of continued and relentless approach to deregulation and finding what the hurdles are for these innovators that we can remove, or even the opposite, or thinking of places where you actually do need smart, updated regulations in order to allow for these technologies to succeed, whether it's drones and cars again. So that's theme number one. Theme number two, we I like to say empowering Americans to innovate. But what we're really talking about there is providing Americans the tools to succeed in the 21st century economy. And first and foremost, that is connectivity. There are 23 million Americans in the U.S. that don't have access to the internet. That's 39% of all rural Americans do not have access to the internet. And this is a real substantive problem. And especially for Americans who need access to telemedicine, who want to stay in their communities and build businesses there, this is a critical issue for the country. So thinking about how we can work to expand connectivity is another big theme. And the third larger theme is defending American technology abroad. And this generally dovetails well with the president's larger sort of trade agenda. But the thinking here, too, is that, you know, Americans create incredible inventions. They develop amazing IP, and oftentimes some of our adversaries in countries across the globe actually take advantage of that. And we need to stand up for American entrepreneurs and do what we can to defend their technologies abroad, whether it's pushing back on forced IP handover as a condition for doing business, whether it's promoting data flows, whether it's pushing back against data localization. Those are all things we try to pursue in order to really protect our greatest innovators here in the U.S.
Great. So our theme here is innovation under threat. Can you talk about how different regulatory barriers and burdens have threatened American innovators and industry? And what do you kind of see as the biggest threat to innovation?
Yeah, I think you guys did a poll before Adam's session. I think it was government regulation was sort of the number one hurdle. And in some ways, I would kind of agree with that sentiment. But I think the one case study that I always like to talk about, which I think kind of captures a lot of the work we're doing, is the efforts we've made in integrating the national airspace. We held an event with the president last summer in the East Room titled American Leadership in Emerging Technology. And we talked about various sort of emerging tech themes and kind of what the government can do better. And one of the sessions was on this integrating the airspace drones question. And this one was very obviously understood by a lot of people in administration. And this idea that, you know, drones were developed here in the U.S. Some of the greatest drone companies in the world are based here in California. Companies like Google, companies like Amazon and in Seattle and so on. But the reality is, you know, we have a regulatory environment that does not allow for commercial operators to actually test their drones. Whether it's Google testing in Australia, whether it's, Amazon's been in the U.K. for years. There's some prominent technology companies that are based in sort of northern Washington, so they can literally drive over the border and fly their drones in Canada. Recounting these stories to administration officials who are pushing very hard on this America First agenda, it can be a very, very powerful tool in order to galvanize action. And coming out of that event, we worked very hard with the FAA to kind of make progress on this issue. And the president signed a presidential memorandum directing the Secretary of Transportation to establish a drone pilot program. And this was a hallmark action coming out of the White House to show that emerging technologies were important and that a presidential signature on an innovative drone program, that's just how important it was. The president himself was willing to push that forward. And this is a great example where, you know, the FAA doesn't have all the answers. The idea that suddenly the FAA is going to know how to regulate drones across all state, local, and tribal communities in the U.S. is a little bit naive. The idea that the same rule would apply well in Manhattan to, you know, the guy in Des Moines is just not feasible. So the purpose of this program was to kind of empower state, local, and tribal communities to work with some of our greatest technology companies to think about the types of operations that would work for their communities, whether it's beyond visual line of sight pipeline inspections, whether it's empowering first responders to have drones be able to access crash sites before ambulances or police can arrive there. And even, you know, the package delivered everyone likes to talk about. And over the last year, there's been a couple of these programs launched. I think there's eight of them that are active, and two more will go online in the next couple of months, and everywhere from Anchorage to San Diego. So it's an exciting program, and I think it really captures this idea that, every locality is different, and we need to gather the data before we can push ahead with national regulations.
And it sort of plays into what Adam was talking about, born free versus not. So do you have some kind of viewpoint on regulation kind of versus physical space versus digital space?
Yeah, the Adam versus bits conversation, I think, was very relevant. I think we think about that quite a lot. To me, the kind of the the diagnosis here, I think, is one where you really got to be careful and understand that the tech stagnation that has occurred in the physical world can very much and oftentimes be associated with regulatory actions by the government. And you know, I think there's some interesting examples that I always like to talk about. I think in the healthcare field is one that is very obvious to me. I think President Nixon declared a war on cancer, and it seems like we're declaring a new one every administration. So we see it in the health space. Transportation is a really obvious example. Cars aren't moving any faster than they were 50 years ago. Planes are actually moving slower now that the Concorde has been decommissioned. We see it with stagnation in sort of agriculture. The productivity sort of per unit acre has actually stagnated over the past decade, while we used to be seeing pretty significant upticks in productivity and crop production. And I think this is in large part, it's very challenging, a lot more challenging to innovate in this space that's highly regulated than in the world of bits where you do have a lot more freedom.
And so it's been just about 18 months. What would you say are some of the biggest regulatory accomplishments or biggest accomplishments of the office so far? And what's taking up your time now?
Yeah, absolutely. So kind of mapping to those priorities, I think in our first bucket of kind of promoting emerging technologies, we obviously had the large drone pilot program launch and get underway. On the autonomous vehicles front, I think that was mentioned in the last session as well. It's, NHTSA, we're trying very hard with them to kind of get in front of the autonomous vehicle issue as quickly as possible, and really understanding that the entire book on regulating vehicles written in an era where every car has a steering wheel, has a brake pedal, has mirrors, and so on. So essentially, you have to sort of throw out the book and start from scratch. And DOT has put out what they call autonomous vehicle 2.0 guidance, and 3.0 guidance is coming out later this year. And this is DOT perpetually trying to kind of be as forward leaning as possible in promulgating great standards for the rest of the country. On that front, I think we've tried to do a lot of work on artificial intelligence. But on the point of the regulatory piece there, under this administration, the first AI-powered diagnostic was approved by the FDA. So diabetic retinopathy is a disease that affects the eyes and millions of Americans across the country. And because of regulatory action by this administration, you actually can get the test done without a doctor in the loop. And this was sort of the first AI-powered diagnostic. In the second category of connectivity, the president earlier this year signed an executive order and a presidential memorandum doing two things. The first was opening up federal lands for siting of broadband. So the idea here is that you'll have easier and quicker siting on federal lands for expanded and new broadband, both in ground and also for 5G deployments. And we've done a lot of work about trying to sort of consolidate the application process for this as well. I think those are a couple things.
Great. And you've hosted the AI for American Industry Summit. That was in May. And what kind of things did you talk about there? What were the results of that conference? What did you find helpful?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think on one end, you have this desire by the administration and our office to really push hard on the deregulation agenda and providing the regulatory environment to allow innovators to succeed. Now, on the other side, what you have to match that with is fostering an innovation ecosystem which actually allows these discoveries to happen in the first place. And we always think a lot about this innovation ecosystem in the U.S. versus some of our adversaries in countries around the world. So what makes the U.S. unique versus some of our adversaries is this one part academia, one part private sector, and one part federal government all working in tandem to create the next great discoveries. And the federal government alone spends about $156 billion a year on R&D. And one of the biggest things we think about is how we can leverage those R&D dollars in a way that can support the private sector and support academia as they also try to drive great discoveries. So for the AI summit, one of our biggest priorities was to figure out how we can support, again, the AI community in the U.S. that in making sure that the next great AI discoveries happen here in the U.S. And We have done that primarily by, first off, prioritizing AI funding. President Trump is the first in history to prioritize artificial intelligence as an R&D priority to a budget sent to Congress. And we're working very hard to try to, we established a select committee on AI, which consists of the most senior R&D officials in the federal government that are working to create a sort of coordinated strategy and effort on American leadership in this particular space. And the last output of that, of the conference, was really to bring to light and stress the breadth of applications that AI is going to have across the country. This isn't something that is going to be just thought about in places like California or places like Silicon Valley. This is something that farmers in Iowa are going to be using when they do their precision agriculture. This is what medical researchers in Boston are going to be using when they attempt to create new drugs. This is what oil extractors in Texas are going to be using when they try to optimize their wells. And it's critical that we create an environment where the most talented artificial intelligence expertise from around the country can actually find its way into all of those industries.
And so on these priorities, we talk a lot about competition between other countries within the state, between different industries. It's very important. And talking about that continued cooperation between the different sectors with the prioritization that the president has done, can you kind of elaborate that a little bit more, how the different sectors can collaborate?
Yeah, I think kind of going back to that sort of one part academia, one part private sector, one part federal government, I think the takeaway there is that the government can't do everything alone. And the greatest tools that the government has in order to deliver its mission to its citizens are often generated or created by folks outside of government. And you're going to hear from Trey Stevens, a former colleague of mine, in a little bit, and he wrote an excellent op-ed in the Washington Post about this exact issue, about the importance of the tech community, in particular, being able to partner with the federal government in order to sort of drive the outcomes that are necessary. And for us, it's critical to kind of maintain an open and free dialogue with the tech community as we try to sort of bring in their technologies into government. And I really think it's critical that government is not seen as something that the tech community doesn't want to work with, but rather something that they're excited to. And for the betterment of this country and for everything we stood for since our founding, that we work in tandem together.
Great. Well, I'm getting the signal that it's about time to wrap up, but is there anything you'd like to mention that maybe I haven't asked you about, or anything else in closing that you'd like to mention?
No, the one thing I would just like to stress, I mean, we are sort of relentlessly pursuing a pro-tech agenda at the White House. My door is always open, and I'm consistently interested in hearing what are the barriers that sort of innovators, entrepreneurs are struggling with every day as they try to build their businesses in the U.S., and everything that we can do to ensure those are removed and can allow you to sort of freely pursue is something I would be excited to pursue. So please give me homework so I can go do that for you.
Great. Well, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.